Our second reading from Holy Scripture comes to us from St. Paul's letter to the Ephesians in chapter 4. So Christ himself gave apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers to equip his people for the works of service, so that the body of Christ might be built up until we all reach the unity of faith and the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. Then we will no longer be infants, tossed back and forth by waves and blown about here and there by every wind of doctrine and by cunning and craftiness of people in their deceitful scheming. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will grow to become in every respect the mature body of him who is the head, that is Christ. From him, the whole body, joined together and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and is built up in love as each part does its work. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
As I've listened to tonight, it didn't take long for me to convince myself that everyone was talking about someone else named Scotty. But here I am. And it's a great honor and privilege to be named the fifth president of Knox Theological Seminary. I want to express my gratitude and thanks to the board of directors for their leadership, for their trust, and for giving me the opportunity to serve in this role. I want to thank my colleagues on the faculty and the staff, who I love dearly and who have become like family to me. I'm grateful for our students who remind us of the important work that we're doing as they live out their education, declaring and demonstrating the gospel of Jesus to a world in need. And to the supporters of Knox, many of whom are here tonight, through your prayer and sacrificial giving, you support this school, and we couldn't do this without you. And for my family, you are an ongoing source of strength, encouragement, and resolve, and I love you. I have been giving some thought to this role as president since taking this on in July, and I've actually been thinking had the same question since I began at Knox 7 years ago. How can Knox Seminary serve the church in effective ways today? This would be an easy question to answer if the list of particulars that the church needed were small and something that seminaries could attend to and get the churches back on track, back on their way. But the reality is that it's very complex. The church's needs are very complex, and it stands at a crossroads today, veering in different directions depending on external opposition and internal challenges. Externally, we see that the church faces opposition on multiple fronts. Intellectually, we're seen as silly. We're seen as intellectually inferior and nothing more than a superstition. Culturally, we are regarded as intolerant, odd, and judgmental. Physically and politically, around the world, there are those who are imprisoned or persecuted for their faith. And yet, however formidable these external pressures are, there are internal challenges that are serious as well. Internally, the church is grappling with its own theological identity. Evidence shows that many Christians have difficulty affirming and understanding the basic tenets of the Christian faith. For some, this has led to Christianity being an emotional experience. Scriptural commands take a back seat, depending on whether one feels that something is right or not instead. Similarly, some will overemphasize the grace of Christ at the expense of his justice. This results in an antinomian Jesus who shrugs off sinful behavior because of the unrestrained freedom that we have in him. Some have twisted the gospel message, claiming that God's desire is for our prosperity and happiness, and the list could go on. And so how can any seminary fulfill its call when the challenges facing the church seem to be insurmountable? What do we do? Where do we begin? What should we be doing differently? Now, as a historian, I tend to find comfort and refuge by learning from our past and seeing God's faithful action in similar situations. In fact, the circumstances I just described are true of today, but they're also true of the second century church. And of course, there are inevitable distinctions between then and now, but the fact is there are remarkable parallels. And so I believe we would do well to learn from our past. It seems natural to ask how the church a millennium ago cultivated the next generation of leaders. How did it push against forces of syncretism? How did it clarify the range of orthodoxy, fight off wayward doctrines arising internally, engage a hostile culture and world? How did it train the next generation of leaders and educate believers in right belief and praxis? Interestingly, the second century church doesn't seem to deploy anything that looks like the modern seminary model. And so one may wonder whether this model is in fact sufficiently responding to the needs of the church today. Today's seminaries tend to function like other institutions of higher learning. Most require students to uproot from their homes, leave their church and existing ministry work. They have to pull kids out of school, got to sell their home, and then relocate in order to get a degree. Their church loses their ministry leader. And that ministry leader in training is divorced from his home church context while he learns how to be a minister. The process is costly. Not only do churches lose their leaders, but students and families pay a high cost, not just financially, but relationally as well. The cost is so great that many would-be seminarians simply choose not to go to seminary at all. It doesn't have to be like this. It seems like something has gone fundamentally wrong. It seems as though churches are serving seminaries rather than the other way around. I believe there's a better solution. And I believe that that solution is to challenge seminaries and churches to do things differently. But this requires a new model. At Knox, rather than making ourselves the focal point, rather than delaying and disrupting ministry work, we are committed to service in the church, with the church, and for the church. At Knox, we believe that students should be able to stay where God has already called them, whether that's here in South Florida, or in Spokane, or in South Africa. We believe that students thrive when they are able to integrate their education within their current ministry context. We believe that church leaders should be involved in the spiritual and pastoral maturation of the students. And we believe that our programs and courses are strengthened when we listen to the churches and have them respond to the education that we provide, and in turn, we can make our courses more applicable, more helpful. And lastly, we believe that seminary education is not just for Christian leaders, but for all the saints of God. And this directly relates to tonight's passage. Ephesians 4, 11 through 16 describes the scope and purpose of the church, or God's people. Christian ministry is a priority for all of God's saints, growing and learning and maturing together in the knowledge of Jesus Christ. The result, it looks a lot like what the church actually needs. There's people growing in confidence in their faith, resilience against the forces that push against us, and the ability to share the truth of the gospel in love. But the beginning of this process is proper training. This is Knox's task, to equip the saints, Christians in any capacity, in all callings, to benefit Christ's body and impact the world. And so as we look forward to seeing this new seminary model flourish, we do so with confidence by looking back at a similar model from the second century. Here we see leaders like Ignatius, Clement, Polycarp, Irenaeus, and others engaged in a similar model of protecting the church, preserving orthodoxy, and cultivating new leaders where they served and while they served. They taught the saints right belief, sound exegesis, theological truth, and gospel fidelity to those who were in a similar position as many ministry people are today. People who are struggling in the day-to-day challenges of life. People who are leaders of faith serving and ministering to communities in need and striving to keep the flock of believers together and aimed in theological unity towards perfection in Christ. Ministry and education went hand in hand, synchronously. And as a result, we see the church of that time bearing much fruit. The same has been true for Knox as we have cultivated this new approach. And while our theological commitments and submission to biblical authority remain unchanged, our student body has grown more geographically, denominationally, and demographically diverse. Norm is a Bible translator in Papua New Guinea. Kathy is starting a Christian and classical school. Vincent is planting a church in South Africa. Jovan and Joseph are ministering in London. Elizabeth is the board of the chairperson of a national campus ministry, and in Sarasota, Chip launched what is now one of the fastest growing churches in America. Oslo, Grand Bahama, Detroit, Atlanta, Los Angeles, Kenya, Dubai, Oxford, Miami, West Palm, and right here in Fort Lauderdale. Our students represent a gospel movement of teachers and lawyers, plumbers, pilots, church planters, nurses, and professional athletes. Knox is a snapshot of the saints of God coming together in new ways, unified in the gospel and in a shared commitment to proclaiming it to the world around them. And so now as we cast our gaze forward, we do so remembering our past, embracing our mission, and pursuing a vision that sees Knox continuing to revolutionize the way seminaries serve the next generation of ministers in, with, and for the church. We are confident about what lies ahead because we have already begun to see the amazing fruit of this new seminary model. So I invite you to join us in this mission. We need your support. I'd ask for you to pray. Pray for us, the faculty and the staff and the leadership of Knox Seminary. Pray for our students and our alumni. And as fellow saints of God, I invite you to learn with us, growing in your faith and confidence to share the gospel, the good news to a world in need, and invite others to join us in this important work. So in closing, this is my prayer for Knox, that together, by God's grace, Knox Seminary will become an even stronger force for Christ's kingdom, comprised of a worldwide community of believers who effectively declare and demonstrate the gospel of Jesus, and that God would, use us, just as he did just a millennium ago, to transform the world. Thank you.